Good afternoon. My name is Hugh Sung. I'm with the Oral History Program here at the Battleship New Jersey, which is docked here in Camden, New Jersey. And today is Wednesday, June 19th of 2019. And we are honored to have on board Mr. Eugene Yuhas, who served in the United States Navy from 1954 to 1958, which included 2 years on board the Battleship New Jersey, which we're on board right now. So without further ado, Mr. Yuhas, I want to welcome you back home. And how's it feel to be back, sir?
Good.
All right.
Okay. Pleasant. Nice to see it.
You said you were back here previously for a reunion?
Yes.
Years ago?
Yeah, this is maybe, I don't know, 10 years ago, something like that. The reunion was here in Cherry Hill, New Jersey. And part of it was, you know, coming back aboard the ship.
Okay.
So that was my last time aboard.
All right. And it's your second time back.
Yeah.
All right. Welcome back home once again. All right. So let's begin by asking what your current age is, sir.
84.
Okay. And let's begin the conversation with how you got involved in the Navy. So why don't you take us from the beginning, like growing up during World War II or any inspirations that may have led you to join?
Well, at that point in time, there was a lot of fellas my age getting drafted into the Army because Korea was in full bloom then. And I didn't really feel like going into the Army. So I thought a better option would be if I enlisted in the Navy, which I did. And then I was assigned to boot camp. At the time, it was done in Bainbridge, Maryland. And after completing boot camp, I was assigned to the USS New Jersey.
Okay. Anything you remember from Bainbridge?
Oh.
Remember what, like, month of the year it was?
Yeah, it was in May, I believe. It was in May. So it'd be May, June, July, August, and I believe it was in September when I went aboard the ship.
Oh, okay. So you went there during the warm months.
Yeah.
Okay. How was it like there? Like, how was maybe like the marching, the cadences, any of them stand out?
Well, it was a different experience, of course, you know, than living at home is where I was. And sometimes, you know, it was a little rough, but you muddled through, and we got through it, and it's all over now.
Okay, so. Yeah. And how old were you at that time?
18.
Okay. And did you go to A school after that?
No, I went to A school after I was aboard ship. They had a request or for a fellow on a ship to go to A school, because I worked in the machine shop at the time, and I went to the machinery repairman school in San Diego, California, from the ship.
Oh, okay.
So the ship sent me there.
Okay, so you came on board without a rate, and then you were sent to San Diego for training?
Yes, well, what happened was I worked in a machine shop before I enlisted in the Navy. So I had some experience in the machine shop. And when I came aboard the ship, I guess the interviewer thought that, being as though I had experience in the machine shop, he assigned me to Able Division, which was, the machine shop was part of that division. And that's how I got into the machine shop.
Okay. All right, so backtrack a little bit. The Korean War conflict that just like ended.
Yes, it did. It did.
Okay. Do you remember how was the sentiment of those around you upon hearing the conflict and its aftermath?
No, not really. I was glad it was over, of course, obviously, but didn't think much about it. Didn't think much about it.
Okay. And where did you see the battleship for the first time?
Well, when I went aboard, after boot camp, I don't know whether I arrived in a bus, but I was kind of in awe because it was my first sighting of the ship, and it just struck me as being huge, you know, and I felt, wow, this is what my assignment is. And I was a little, you know.
Right. That was the first time you saw a warship?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. You don't remember, like, which port it was?
It was in Norfolk.
Okay.
At the time. It was in Norfolk.
All right. I believe
that was the home port of the ship.
Yes.
At that time.
Yes, I believe so. I think for at least three of those four battleships. All right, so coming on board for the first time, where did they assign you first for the machine shop?
Yeah, machine shop, yeah.
All right, so that was your first assignment?
Yes.
All right. How was the orientation like? Like meeting the officers or the chiefs?
Kind of uneventful. They assigned us, me to an able division, and that's, you know, that's where we were all ganged up in one one big compartment, and there wasn't much that I can think of that stood out.
Okay. All right, so after training and then going back to the ship to resume your machine shop duties, why don't you talk about machine shop duties for the historical record?
Well, what we did basically in the machine shop was repair work, mostly valves. You know, we'd reseat the valves on valves that needed repair. There wasn't much else, you know, we could do on the ship, in the shop, because anything that was very involved would be shipped out, you know, to get repaired. So basically, we did repair work on the ship.
Okay. Anything that broke or could have worn out on the ship?
Yeah.
Yeah, you repaired here. Okay. So after coming on the ship and going out to sea, do you remember where you went?
Oh, yeah, we did our first stop was Mayport, Florida. I remember we stopped in Mayport just for a visit. And then the next one was Guantanamo Bay, Cuba. It was for a shakedown cruise. After that, and training, by the way, after that, we were headed for a Mediterranean cruise. First one being Gibraltar, and those nine ports that we stopped in.
Okay.
Italy and, you know, Spain. And that was good. That was a nice trip.
Okay.
Because we had an opportunity. When the ship stopped in port, they had tours, you know, which was nice because, you know, you just went from the ship onto a bus and they took you to, you know, various places, like in Cannes, you went to the that gambling casino, and there was a lot of good stuff you seen, you know, on a tour.
Okay, so you took tours of these ports, right?
Yeah.
Were there tours on the ship at this time or no?
What do you mean by tours on a ship?
Like people allowing to come on board the ship for tours, not this time?
No. But what struck me is, though, when we were on the cruise, some of the young officers, maybe recently married, they had their wives meet them in port. So when they, you know, when they arrived in that particular port, their wife was waiting, you know, on the dock. And they made a little vacation of it, because when we came to port, we stayed for, you know, usually a week, so it gave some time to see the sights and I guess whatever it is they whatever it was the function of these ships being in the port.
Oh yes. So they would tell their wives that the ship would be there and they would meet them
there?
Yeah, I
thought it was nice.
All right. Any of these ports stand out, like anyone that you remember from like a time being on shore?
Yeah, there was, like, we were in Barcelona on, you know, over the holiday. That was Christmas, and we had a big, you know, we went ashore. Or was that New Year's? I can't remember. It was one or the other. And we had a good time. But my whole experience, you know, on the cruise was good. It was nice.
Okay.
And my job then, see, when we were underway, my assignment was main control. It was a phone watch in number 3 engine room. And this is where all the boiler rooms and the engine rooms were tied in. And the officer of the watch, you know, was there. So if anybody wanted to get in touch with the officer to watch in the engine rooms, you know, the other engine rooms or the boiler rooms, they would call in. It was, you know, a little primitive by today's standards. And I would relay the message to the officer to watch. So that was when the ship was underway. The ship was in port. I either worked in the machine shop or I was assigned duty on the launches,
Launch the boats?
Yeah.
Okay.
I was like what they call the engineer on there. Coxswain would give me the bells, and that's the way it worked. Are you familiar with the way it worked on the launches, the big launches to bring the guys into port?
Why don't you talk about it for the historical record?
What it was you had a coxswain who steered the launch, and I was the engineer on it because I was in the engineering department. And there was one other fellow, I think he was at the front of the launch, you know, because when it pulled up, he'd jump aboard, he'd jump off the ship and onto the dock. Well, they had a bell system. So when the coxswain wanted you to go forward, I forgot exactly what the bell was, but you'd get one bell. When you start slowly, if he wants you to pick up, he gives you two bells. I think full speed, maybe three bells. And then reverse was, I think, maybe four bells. But that's the way it was done back then.
Okay.
And also I had some duty on the officer's gig, we called it. The captain had his own gig, and the officers had theirs. So I was the engineer on the officer's gig. So
okay, and gig refers to,
that's a launch. Okay, we called it a gig, but it's like a motor launch.
Okay.
The officer's boat.
All right. So you would do this whenever the sailors would go out to Liberty, right?
Yeah, Liberty. Okay. And then sometime I'd do the officer's thing. You know, that was interesting because I think there was 3 of us on the officer's gig.
Okay.
And when we were heading in from the ship, 2 of us would hang on the side. You know, you just hold on the side of the launch. And if it was cold, you froze out there, you know. But it looked nice, you know. So I thought that was pretty neat.
Right. Did you ever do these for other duties like transport? Supplies, mail call, or personnel?
No, strictly for like the Liberty and getting the officers off the ship to the dock.
Okay. While we're at it, let's continue to talk about Liberty. So You said when you got on board, you were able to go out and do tours. What was it like interacting with the people of, let's say, Barcelona, Spain, or the food that was there?
Yeah, well, we didn't have too much interaction with the with the residents. I enjoyed the tours. Of course, some of the guys would head right for the bars. But that wasn't me. I, you know, wasn't a drinker. So, but there was very little interaction with the residents of the cities.
Okay. Did you go to restaurants or stores a lot?
Yeah, we bought souvenirs and what have you. Mailed them home. There were some good bargains over there, too.
Okay.
Because the dollar was high at that point in time.
All right. And there was no language barrier?
A lot of them spoke English. Some didn't. But I don't recall there. You made yourself.
Okay. And you would ship them home through the ship's postal?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. How was mail call like?
Well, it was good. I mean, if you had letters coming, it was good. If you didn't, then it wasn't so good.
How often did you get it?
I didn't do too much. I get a little letter from home once a month, and I'd write once a month, not that much.
Okay. Did mail come, like, periodically or whenever mail came?
Yeah, it was whenever, I guess, they could get it to the ship.
Okay.
Because if we were underway, I guess it had to come. I have to send it over through.
All right. Any other ports that stood out for you?
It's been a while.
Okay.
So I don't recall anything standing out.
Okay. Did you ever go through the Panama Canal?
No.
Okay. How about Pearl Harbor?
No, we were strictly in the Mediterranean, the Sixth Fleet.
Okay. Did you remember the ship sailing with the other Iowa-class battleships, like alongside?
No, I don't think they were part of our group.
Okay.
They had some smaller ships, like the destroyers that were part of our group. But I don't recall seeing the other battleships.
Okay.
I know there was a couple of them, Wisconsin, I think, and Iowa.
Okay. Because these ships were photographed together once.
Oh, yeah?
Yes. You might have been on duty at the time because, of course, the ships were running. But they all came together for one photo op.
Oh, I don't recall that. Well, I don't know when when it was.
And then there was another time when the Wisconsin had an accident. I'm not sure if you heard about that. It may have spread through Scuttlebutt, but the Wisconsin T-boned a destroyer.
Oh, yeah? No, yeah. I didn't. I never heard of that one.
Okay, and there's a photograph of it next to the New Jersey, and one of them looks shorter.
Really?
Yeah, because Wisconsin lost some of its bow.
Oh, wow. I didn't hear about that one.
Okay. All right. Besides Barcelona, did you, stop by in Italy or Greece?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, we were in Athens. We did a tour of Athens. Like I said, the first port was Gibraltar. Second, Spain. We did Valencia, Spain, I remember. And there was 9 ports we did. I don't recall them all just at the moment. But
okay, not a problem. If any of them stood out, like anything you remember from them?
Not really, no. Well, Nice was nice. We stopped in Cannes, France. And while we were there, we had an opportunity to go ashore, and that's a big perfume center in Cannes. And I remember we bought some that high-class perfume at a very reasonable price, which I sent home, which to my mom, and she never used it, so that was... Anyway, it was something that I thought was pretty interesting.
Okay. Any exercises you remember the ship participated in? Either going full speed or opening fire, any of its weapons?
Yeah, they did when we were in Cuba. We were in a shakedown cruise. And it was, you know, they had training that was, I guess, on schedule. And I know, remember them firing the guns. But I was in the engineering department, so I was below decks. So all I seen was four walls, really, down there.
Okay. You were able to, you knew when the guns fired when you're down there.
Oh, yeah.
So you still
felt. You could feel it, yeah, the vibration, sure.
Okay. But you never got to see them out on the decks?
No.
Okay. Do you know if you're still able to feel the 5-inch guns from where you were, or just the 16-inch?
The 5-inch, I don't know if they fired them that much. And the only time they did was when we were in training in Cuba.
Okay.
That was the only time they did it.
They sounded a salvo alarm before they fired. Do you remember hearing that?
No.
Okay. There's a possibility that probably couldn't be heard everywhere.
Yeah, well, us, like I say, I was in way below decks in the number three engine room, so I think that pertained more to the, you know, to the deck.
Okay.
Deckhands.
So they probably heard it because they had to, whereas you were kind of safe just feeling the concussion, so you weren't in danger of, like, the recoil or the blast.
No.
All right. So you were firing targets while you were in Cuba?
Yeah.
So they had a few places set?
Yeah, they had, like, these, they would drag along, I guess, like a decoy, and, you know, they would shoot at it, I guess, for target practice.
Okay.
That was my extent of, you know.
Okay. Do you remember the ship stopping by at Gitmo and going to shore?
Yeah.
Yes. How was Gitmo like?
Well, as I said, I was, after I completed 2 years on the ship, they had a request for me, you know, for somebody to go to Cuba. They needed an MR3. And I fitted the bill because I still had 2 years to do.
Okay.
And I went down to Cuba. So it was, you know, I was there for 2 years.
Okay. We'll talk about Cuba more. A few more things that I want to ask about while you're on the ship. So from your time on the battleship, why don't we talk about everyday life on the ship? So while you're not on duty, like any recreation you remembered or access to periodicals?
Yeah, that was very good. We had a library, I know, on the ship that I frequented, and I did a lot of reading with these pocketbooks, you know, because what happens is you do a lot of waiting in line, waiting for this, waiting for that, waiting for chow. So while we're waiting, I started reading. I never read so much in my life as when I was on the ship. There's nothing else to do, to tell you the truth. And I haven't read that much since, to tell you the truth.
All right. Were you reading mostly novels,
yeah,
magazines, or nonfiction?
Yeah, novels, yeah.
Okay.
You know, the pocketbooks, the ones you could put in your back pocket.
Okay, so were you able to, like, check them out of the library, or you had to read them there?
No, you could check them out. You can buy them on shore, bring them aboard.
Okay. How was the food like on board?
Oh, I can't complain.
Okay.
They kept you alive, right?
Yeah. Was this the only ship you were in?
Yes.
Okay. Because I was told that the smaller the ship, the worse the food.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. Like, you were able to have eggs how you would like it, right? Scrambled over easy?
Well, I don't know about that. I think they just you took what was there, as far as I can remember.
Oh, okay.
It wasn't like a cafeteria. You know, it was a chow line.
All right.
You went through with a tray and then that. I guess you had some selections that I can remember, but it was pretty good. Nobody lost any weight because of it.
Okay. Did you ever get to see any USO shows, whether on board or on shore?
They had, the ship had a movie every night on a fantail, weather permitting. And you know, after duty. Most of the guys who were interested were stopped by to watch the movie. And that was about it. We never had any stage shows that I'm aware of.
Okay. All right, because I think Bob Hope was on this ship. Well, he's on the ship several times. Not sure if he was on board during this commissioning, the second one. Right, but you didn't see like any on shore, like
no.
That. Okay. What can you tell us about interactions between the officers, the enlisted, and the non-commissioned officers? Anything you recall from them?
No, uneventful. There was nothing out of sorts.
Okay. Who would you answer to during your duties, whether in the machine shop or down the engine room?
Well, in the machine shop, we had a first class who was in charge of the shop, and then we had a warrant officer who was above him. Now, him I remember. Chief Warrant Officer Zolusky, his name was. And he was tough. He was a tough taskmaster, but he was good. And he kind of came up the ranks and, you know, starting off as a seaman, and he made Warrant Officer. And I kind of liked the guy. And he's the guy who had me, you know, he's gave me an opportunity to go to Class A school in San Diego. So the ship sent me all the way out, you know, out to San Diego just to go to school. It was pretty good.
Okay, so this warrant officer was in charge of the machine shop, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Among other things.
All right, so you had more than one duty.
Yeah, sure.
Okay. When he came in, everybody's standing attention, right?
Not really.
Okay.
No, not if you were working.
All right. So he wasn't that kind of person who might pull rank.
No.
All right. They said those were the ones who didn't respect others.
Yeah. No, he was a good guy.
Okay. No other high-ranking officer ever came in, right, that required standing attention?
No.
Okay. All right. Anything else you remember on board New Jersey before we talk about your duties in Gitmo?
No, I think that covers it. I can't think of anything else that would be pertinent.
Okay. And by the way, up in our exhibits, we do have a photograph of the whole crew. Do you remember being part of that?
No, not that I know of.
Oh.
No.
Okay. All right, not a problem, because we might be able to point you out. Is if you were there while the photo was taken.
No, what year was that to me? Who knows?
Yeah. Was during this commission, that's all I could say.
Oh, okay.
The ship's second commission. All right, so upon leaving the ship, you were then transferred to Guantanamo Bay, or Gitmo.
Yeah.
So that was and still is a U.S. Navy base.
Yes.
What can you talk about stepping onto that base?
Well, it was funny because my rating was a machinery repairman, third class at the time. So stepped off into Guantanamo, I go up to see the division officer who was going to assign me my duties. So when I go up, they needed somebody on base police. So guess where I went?
Master at Arms?
Base police.
Okay, so that's separate from Master at Arms.
Yeah, they had their own police force.
Oh, I see.
And that's where I was for a while.
Okay.
But I wasn't very happy on the base police.
Were you issued a sidearm or just a billet club?
Yeah.
All right. 45?
Yeah. And of course, you didn't take it, you know, when you came on duty, you picked up your sidearm, and when you left, you know, you returned it. Which, I don't know if you needed a sidearm, you know, in Guantanamo, but that's the way it was. So about a year later, see, I wanted to get into the machine shop, which is where I should have been. So this one of my fellow shipmates, he wanted to be, he was in a machine shop, which he didn't want to be. He wanted to be on base police, so we put in a request for transfer. So we kind of swapped duties.
Okay.
So I went to the machine shop, he went on base police. So after that base police thing, I could never be a policeman. You know, it just didn't gel with me.
Right. But you had no encounters, right?
No.
Okay.
And your duties there was, you know, we would be, you would ride around in a Jeep all day. And you look for, if there was any problems or if anybody needed assistance, you'd help them out. So I did that for a while. And then for a while, I was on what they call harbor police. They had a launch, I think from the year one. It was an old clunker, and that's what we, that was the harbor police. And for a while I was on that one. That was a little bit better than driving around in a Jeep all day. So here you drove around in a, you know, a motor launch in the bay, which was good. Because they had, in Guantanamo, you had people lived in Guantanamo, fishermen, they had to get through the base waters to get out to sea. So part of your duties, like a base police, was to, you know, make sure that there's no problems, you know, with the fishermen heading out to sea. They had to, like little boats, you know, one or two guys in a boat. They'd go out fishing, and then they'd have to come back through the... And you're supposed to log them in and log them out.
Okay.
So that was part of our duties there on the base.
All right. So you were interacting with U.S. military personnel as well as Cubans, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Which very little, though. You know. And then there was a lot of people who lived in Guantanamo were employed on the base.
Okay, Cubans employed.
Yeah. Cubans, so when they would come to work in the morning, they'd come on motor launches. And we had a big dock there where they would come ashore, go about their business, and then at night they'd go back, you know, back to their homes.
Okay. But when you swapped duties, you felt happier in the machine shop, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
In fact, that's what I did when I got out of the Navy. I had my own machine shop.
Okay. Now, why don't you talk about the machine shop duties on Gitmo and compare it with your machine shop duties here on this ship? Like, any differences you remember?
Mm. No, we did mostly the same work, repair work. We didn't do a lot because the Cubans, you know, who were employed there, did a lot of it. So we just kind of helped out, more or less.
Okay.
Because, you know, you don't want to take their work away, so...
Did you repair, like, different kind of equipment?
Same thing with valves and, you know, stuff that pertained to the ships they did there.
Okay.
Same thing.
All right. Okay. The organization was the same, right, as far as leadership?
Yeah. Yeah, we had a chief petty officer who was in charge. Below him, first class.
Okay.
And then us peons, right, who did the work.
Now, also, like, during this time, the Cuban Revolution was, like, kind of brewing up. Do you remember that going on around you in the base?
He had not really taken a foothold. You know, he was out there in the boondocks fighting.
Fidel Castro and his gang, right?
Yeah, so we were still able to go into the city, you know, on Liberty. After I left, I think is when he, you know, started showing his, you know, his strength. But while I was there, you know, he was not a big deal.
Okay, so at that time he was just a rebel.
Yeah,
and wasn't much concern.
Yeah. Of course, as it turned out, he, you know.
Okay.
Because when I was there, his name was Batista. He was the... He was the fellow in charge there. That's the Cuban president or whoever he was. So Castro was just a, like you said, he was just a rebel at that point in time.
Okay. Anything else you remember during your time at Gitmo?
No, other than, you know, it was, weather was sure nice. and you kind of had, you had a lot to keep you amused if you, you know, if you so desired. They had a, I remember they had a, the barrel club, they called it. That was, where they had, you know, for a couple drinks.
All right, that's like beers. A bar, right?
Yeah, like bars, like a, yeah.
Okay.
And that was frequented quite a lot by guys on the base. And they had shows, movies every night.
Okay, all on Liberty in Cuba?
That was right on the base.
Okay.
Right on the base.
Yes, and how was Liberty in Cuba if you participated?
Good. I went over a couple times. Not to Havana. I never made Havana. Although some guys did. But the town, like adjacent to the base, was small, you know, was not much doing.
Okay. And interaction with the Cuban people,
yeah,
was okay?
Yeah, it was no problem, yeah.
Okay. And after this, you left the Navy, right?
Yeah, after 4 years, yeah. My enlistment was up.
Okay, and then you took your skills with you and went to the machine shop, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So, looking back at your time in the Navy, is there any way the Navy, like, had an impact in your life that you took with you?
I enjoyed it. Thought about re-enlisting, you know, but I didn't do it. I just felt that maybe there was more opportunities outside the Navy. But all in all, it was a good experience, I thought. And I would certainly recommend it to, you know, I got grandkids who would like to see. In fact, my grandson, the oldest one, just was discharged. He was an officer in the Navy. He went ROTC. And my second grandson is an Army ROTC. So I've got two grandsons in the military. And I'm pretty proud of that.
Okay, Mr. Yuhas, we're just about coming to the closing of this interview. So the first question that I have is there anything that I didn't ask that you would like to talk about for the historical record?
No, really. I think you covered the bases pretty accurately, yeah.
Okay. And so as you're well aware, this interview would join the 400 we have to be archived here, as well as sent to institutions that will permanently archive them and make them available to writers and researchers and anybody else who might be willing to watch this to learn about our history.
Uh-huh.
So is there anything you'd like to say as a way to leave a message to whoever might be watching this later?
Well, no, other than my time in the Navy was a good experience, and I would encourage a lot of youngsters to go the same route. I think it's good. If you're not going to college, you should, you know, consider going into the service, because there's a lot of benefits that are available to veterans. And just that it's a good deal. I think it's a good deal.
Okay, absolutely, sir. All right, we can conclude this interview. So first of all, Mr. Eugene Yuhas, I want to thank you for your service, taking the time to come join us for this interview. And once again, welcome back home to the Battleship New Jersey. So once again, my name is Hugh Sung. I am the assistant with the Oral History Program here at the Battleship New Jersey, docked here in Camden, New Jersey. And today is Wednesday, June 19th of 2019. And our interview guest is Mr. Eugene Yuhas from Oatley Beach, New Jersey. So this recording and any indexes, transcripts, keyword indexes will be stored here on the Battleship New Jersey, as well as the Library of Congress Veterans History Project and the New Jersey State Library Systems. And all these recordings will be made available to writers, researchers, teachers, and historians. And my name is Hugh Sung, signing off. All right, thank you, sir.